hope you're having a wonderful day today in this weird and wonderful world that we are now living in, which is COVID-19. I hope you're all staying safe and at home and slightly enjoying the weather as much as you can. It is very nice out there. I have a little balcony I can sit on and read, which is perfect for this time of year. I have been away from YouTube for a very long time because I kind of wanted to work out which works best for me in terms of blogging and vlogging. I am now going to be doing this regularly, only 2 times a month, and that is for the TBR and the wrap-up. So I'm starting today with my April wrap-up, which includes so many different things, from things to watch, to listen to, and to read, and I hope you pick one of these things up, whether it be a book, a podcast, or a film, or a TV show, and let me know down in the comments what you thought of them. I'm going to start off with some books, and the first one I'm going to talk to you about is The Postman Always Rings Twice by James M. Cain. And I'd have this on my shelf for years and years, and I've always kind of seen him around, and obviously he wrote Mildred Pierce, so I was very interested to kind of look into how he writes and characters he kind of brings up in his writing. So this one was about a man and a woman, and the man kind of comes into the woman's life, and he's this hot, like, kind of guy who just kind of mopes around the world and does whatever he feels like. And she's like settled down with her kind of annoying husband, and he kind of breaks that up a bit, and you see that tension starting to build, and it's a great sort of 1950s, like, I feel like it's 1950s. Remember when this was, yeah, this is 1940s, so it's a mixture of the two, I think, in terms of what I perceive as like that kind of era. Talking about like the relationships between men and women, and sort of the drama that stories had at that time that I think we've lost a bit of now, but this really does show you some high drama. And if you're into that, I would definitely give it a read. And it's quite short, so it's not too bad. Continuing with those short reads, I did read a fantastic little poetry collection done by Steve Camden, which is Everything All at Once. And this is basically set in a secondary school and talking about like the hard times that you have, from like, gossip to fears to the way you're kind of looked at in secondary school, because that's a very defining moment in your life. And yeah, it definitely rang true and felt very relatable. And I'd give it a whirl if you're into your poetry. Next, continuing the slightly short books, I have a middle grade series that I absolutely loved so much, and was so glad I picked this up. This is called Scream, The Mummy's Revenge by Andrew Beasley, and it's published by Osborne, who are absolutely fantastic in terms of children's books. And this is a 9-12 murder mystery, well, supernatural murder mystery, about the set in Victorian times. You've got the two kids whose names completely escaped me. So Billy is one over here, and then this is Charlie, and it's a fantastic, just ridiculous story of how there is this mummy running loose around Victorian Edinburgh, stealing everybody's jewels. I don't know what he's gonna do, but he did do some weird stuff in here. And the ending scene is just hilarious, and so he has this great way of sort of taking the mick out of mysteries, but also making it very childlike and just fun and enjoyable, and I loved every minute of it. I thought it was really, really, really good. I think I have about one last short book left, and that is South and West by Joan Didion. I have always wanted to read some Joan Didion's, and the best way to describe her is an observer of sort of society and history and big things that happen. So she writes for the Time magazine and lots of other, I think she does write for Time. I know she writes for very big magazines. She's, and this particular little short observation is about her in the 70s going through the South of America and kind of relaying different people's opinions of different towns and how they are developing and how sort of the question of race is developing in terms of opinions and how we've moved forward in society and how we haven't. And it's a very, very interesting read, very sad as well to read some of these opinions that she tells you about, because the opinions have not changed very much, unfortunately. Next, I'm going to mix it up a little bit and give you some of the TV that I have been watching, which has been absolutely fantastic. I have been watching The Split. If you don't know anything about The Split, it is basically about a family of divorce lawyers, and they have this big practice in the centre of London, and you follow Hannah, who is the kind of the rebel of the family, and she quits the firm and goes to work for another firm, and she then has all these like personal problems attached, and it just goes, it explodes from drama to drama to drama, which is why I absolutely loved it and couldn't stop watching it with my mum. And I've just finished season 2 in April, and that was absolutely fantastic, and I'm really sad that there's nothing more to watch from that show. I hope they do more of it. Absolutely, really, really spot on, and the actors are so, so good in it, and you're just like sitting on your seat going, is she gonna do it? Is she gonna do it? And you'll probably know what I'm talking about if you've watched the show. Next, I finished the OC, which was taking me back to my teenage years, and it was just so much fun to watch it. It has aged actually really, really well. Basically, the OC is set in Orange County in California, and it is about a teenager called Ryan who has had a really bad, like, I wouldn't say it. Yeah, he's had a bad upbringing, and he also has just had the worst things thrown at him in life. But Sandy finds him, and Sandy is this attorney that is intent on saving the world, and I love Sandy. He's fantastic. And his wife is works in her father's company, and it's, they're like housing real estate kind of moguls, and like one of the most influential families in the sort of town. So it's that great contrast of just kind of from the hardest point to like the richest point, if that makes sense, in life. And it is full of drama, it's very teenagey, but it was a great fun to watch, and I'm gonna move on to the next season, because I've watched the first season when I was younger and never kind of continued, which is a bit sad. So looking forward to going to the next one. So that was everything I finished in terms of TV. The other things I kind of watched in and out of was Vera, because I love Brenda Blyton. She is amazing. Vera is so cool. Like, even the really long episodes, but you just maintain being gripped throughout. It's fantastic. Great writing and great acting. I also dipped into The West Wing, because I'd recently finished The Good Wife. Rewatching The Good Wife of season 1, and it's like, I need some more lawyer and political drama in my life. I'm missing it. So I started watching that, and that was really, really good. And I forgot how great Michael Sheen is. He's a really fantastic actor. I also keep continuing to watch bits of The American Housewife, which is a hilarious, like, 20-minute drama about this woman who lives in this, I think it's called Newport, it's this town that's full of very, very rich people, and they're all like juice mums and fittest, and they do 50 types of sports, and they all have these mega healthy meals for their kids, and she just likes to eat Cheetos and be kind of just her own size, and that doesn't always fit in with that particular town's idea of what life should be. And it's about her kind of figuring out that nobody cares, just be yourself. And I love it. The main actress in it who plays the mum is hilarious and really good. And the girl in it, which I didn't realise till last night, is actually the young girl in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, which is really, really cool. She's a great actress. And yeah, that's everything in terms of TV. Back to books. Back to books. I also finished one of my book clubs. My only book club. I half do book clubs with other people, which is really good fun. We're trying to do buddy reading, and then it fails usually, but it's fun to try. This month's book club pick was Illuminae by Amie, Kaufman, and Kristoff, which is a great reread for me. I absolutely love this. It does look very fat, but as you can see, most of it is sort of conversation text and like weird countdown pages. So you get through it quite quickly, and it's a great story, and it's set in space, and it's all about AI and that kind of integration into sort of society. And yeah, it's a great fun thrillery read, and I can't wait to reread the second one. I haven't actually read the third, which is really bad, but I now have an excuse to finish the series. Next I have a manga I have been reading and absolutely loving, and that is the Golden, I think you say Camden, and this one is Volume 2, and it's by Satoru, Noda, and it is hilarious and also really thrilling at the same time, and it also has these little historical anecdotes about the particular tribe that this young girl is from, and her name is, I'm going to say it wrong, Vera, I think is how you say it, but yes, it is really thrilling. She comes across this soldier who is immortal, and they go on this quest to find this treasure that's been hidden by a set of prisoners who have tattoos on their back that are the map to the treasure, and it's really, really cool. And it's set in Japan in the snowy mountains, really. Landscapes in here, I'll see if I can find one, are absolutely just stunning. They're really beautiful. Yeah, I'm really enjoying it. I can't wait to get my volume 3, which is on the way, and start reading it. Then we have another book club, which is Empress of All Seasons by Emiko, and this was amazing. So, so good, and such a quick read for me. I absolutely love the characters, especially Mari, who is she is a young girl growing up in a village up in the mountains, and it's mostly all women, and it's hard to describe them. They're supposed to be women who basically cheat men and get their fortunes and then run away back to the village, and and so she is not the most beautiful of young girls in that village, which is why she has been picked for this particular quest to be part of to be part of this thing of how I've lost all words. I don't know what's wrong with me. Basically, to be part of this like Hunger Games-esque I've forgotten what the word I'm looking for. Oh, it'll come to me. And there are four different rooms, and she has to complete each and every room in order to get to the last room. And once she completes it, she will marry the young, soon-to-be emperor. And yeah, it's really good fun. It's really fast-paced, and the characters are really interesting. Tara is the young, soon-to-be emperor, and he's not irritating like you would expect him to be. He's kind of got this sort of own mindset on where he's going, and she kind of trailblazes that, and that's really cool, and I like that very much. And I'm kind of sad that it's just a one-timer. It's one timer. There is no more, unfortunately. But I really would love there to be more. So, Emiko, if you feel like writing some more, I would really like that. Next on my list. And then I will switch to the movie. is Down Among the Sticks and Bones by Seanan McGuire. And I love this writer. She is a fantastic writer. Like, there's nothing like her. She has this sort of, I don't know what it is, she's almost like C.S. Lewis-esque in the way she kind of describes her magical world, and just completely, like, you go into it and you can't move. It's so, and her, the way her writing is, it's very lyrical, and it just kind of flows beautifully. So this particular one is the second in the series, and it is the story of Jack and Jill, and obviously they're all sort of you kind of meet everybody in the situation who has been to different worlds in the first book, and then you get to, the idea is that she's going to each of the different characters and explaining their world. And so this is Jack and Jill, and they go to a particular world that is just past the moors, where there is a town and there is a vampire, and then there is also this guy who likes to teach and help kids understand sort of woodwork and practical things. So yeah, and it's about them two as sisters, and they're kind of figuring out how they've kind of come apart and can come back together again. And yeah, I really enjoyed it. It's a very quick read, but she is absolutely fantastic, and I can't wait to read the next one in the series. Okay, back to movies. I don't like saying movies, I don't know why I said that. I say film. Not that it makes much difference. Anyway, the films I watched in the month of April are Minions, which I'd had on my shelf for ages, and I kind of suddenly looked at it and it was like, right, I need to decide if I definitely want to keep this or I don't want to keep this anymore. And so I watched it, and I, because you know when you kind of have that obsession with that one thing, you just want to watch everything about it. And I think that was what I felt when I watched Despicable Me, and I just fell in love with the Minions, and they're so cute and yellow, and they're wearing dungarees. But yeah, after watching it again, a few years later, I didn't find it as good as I did the first time, and I felt like the plot lacked a lot, and even though I loved the narration of Jeffrey Rush, it wasn't good enough for me to keep on my shelf, because I have less space now, and I must remind myself I have less space. The next thing I watched was The Addams Family, which is not the Christina Ricci versions. For some reason I struggle with that word. It was the animated version, which was done last year in October, and has Chloe Grace Moretz and Charlize Theron in it, and they are just incredible. It's a really good story. It's great for kids because it not only kind of introduces them to the Addams Family and to the different quirks of like the TV show and the old movies. But it's also just a fantastic story that you kind of can relate to because it's got that modern day touch to it. And yeah, I really, really enjoyed it. Next, I watched The Father of the Bride 2 because I've watched the first one the month before and I absolutely love those movies. They're hilarious. I really wish Steve Martin was my dad. He's so nice in it. And also, it's just a cute, see, family film story that you would just love and really uplifts you, especially in these times. But yeah, definitely check it out. Going the completely opposite direction, I watched Judy, and I'd heard so much about this film, and I put it off and put it off, because, you know, when you hear about biopics that are so, so amazing, you kind of just want to not watch it at the time, because you have this inkling in the back of your head that goes, oh, it's probably not going to be what I want it to be. But I watched it anyway, and I loved it. It was beautiful, so sad. I cried twice in this film. It's basically about Judy Garland's life towards the end and about her two children that she'd had with her, not her last, but the one before her last husband. And it's just, it is terribly sad to see the effects of mistreatment and not being able to kind of find your own, to have found your own voice and then to not express it in the way you want to, and to just kind of trail towards the end without that kind of, with that love that she had from the people, but not kind of the love that she wanted, and it was really sad. Let's move to something a bit happier. I did also watch The Paper, which was on my Studio Classic Amazon subscription, and that was so good. That was a really good fast-paced thriller set in a paper called The Sentinel with Michael Keaton as the main character, and he's basically, there's this double homicide in Williamsburg, and it's obviously set in New York, and they're... It's about his paper breaking the next part of the story. So, missing the first part completely and doing something about, like, I think it was parking. Something ridiculously silly that shouldn't be a headline. You think shouldn't be a headline because it's so not, like, as interesting as you would expect. But yeah, so they missed the first headline and then it's about them kind of taking that headline back. And it's him and it's Glenn Close. She's insane in this film, but really, really good in showing a female character with that amazing drive to just get to where she wants to in her career. So yeah, I really, really enjoyed this. This was a fantastic film. And it was an hour and 52 minutes, and it flew by. I didn't notice where I was or how long it had actually been on for. Last but not least, I watched The Princess Diaries, which is one of my favourite films from when I was a teenager. I literally can quote that film, and I didn't realise that until I rewatched it. But it is basically about Mia Thermopolis, who is this young girl who lives in San Francisco, and she likes to be invisible, and is invisible, and then her grandmother comes to stay and tells her that she is a princess. And she's the princess of Genovia. And obviously everything changes and things with this guy called Michael and her friends and school, and it's just the ridiculousness and the hilarity of it is just great, and it's such a fun family film to watch. Definitely check it out. Now I have a few more comics and one more book left to show you that I read. I'm up. Well, you'd expect it. It's Thanos. So I also the last book I read was Thanos, Titan Consumed by Vera Lygra, and this is basically the story of how Thanos became Thanos. It's because Thanos is a hard one to say, and it gets mixed up and everything. But yeah, so this tracks his childhood all the way up to him meeting Gamora and finding Nebula, and kind of that dynamic starting to show. And it's really, really fascinating. I really loved it. And I would like this to be turned into a film, because I think it's got a lot to say about a character that we, as comic book and movie, superhero movie fans, are so like enamored and like interested in this character. And I think this would answer a lot of questions, but also kind of for those who, because he's a very one of those characters where you either hate him or you love him, and this kind of this changes your opinion, I would say that. But yeah, definitely go check it out. It's a chunky one, but it's a lot of the chapters are quite quick, so you can get through it. And it's also familiar territory because it's Marvel, so you know where you are. You don't feel lost. You feel like you're just in Marvel land, enjoying it. Which sounds weird, but you get what I mean. Then I read something called The Black Mage, which is done. It's written by Daniel Barnes and DJ Kirkland. This was given to me by Only Press last year at Book Expo, and I'm very thankful. Thank you for giving this to me. It was a great read. I really enjoyed it. It's basically about this weird magical school where the headmaster is in a Ku Klux Klan esque outfit, and a young black student arrives, and he's the only one, and he's kind of trying to figure out what the hell is going on here, with the help of some very cool and important ancestors, through their ghosts. Ghosts? Are they ghosts, or are they like spirits? Spirits. I'm gonna say spirits. But yeah, it's a great fun read. Some of the scenes in this are insane. Like, the artwork is beautiful. The colours are so, so cool. The only thing I would say is I wanted more. There wasn't, for me, enough dialogue and enough sort of background to the school and where it's going in it. So I would like to see more of it. Please. Anyway. Next, I have a comic. I also got a book expo last year, and this is from... and this is The Magician's Alice story, and this is done by Lev Grossman and Lilah, Sturges and Pius back. And this, I really enjoyed this, but I've forgotten so much of this world. After reading this, I was like, I need to reread these books. I'd forgotten everything, and I'd watched part of the TV series as well, so I thought, oh yeah, I'll be fine. Dipping into this world, be absolutely fine. No. I've forgotten all of this. So this follows Alice's story and how she goes to school and how she kind of works out her relationships with these two guys whose names I've completely forgotten. Quentin, the main guy, and then I think it's Pete. It's something beginning with P. And basically they're all three of them are really big fans of this book, and it's about them figuring out kind of how much of an effect this book is going to have on their lives. So it's a really good, it's a good standalone story in itself, but I think I would have been better to have reread the books and then read this, because I think I would understand the significance more. But yes, thank you very much for this. It was really, really good fun. Last but not least, the last comic I read was Skyward Volume 1. Ron is now one. Yeah, I really enjoyed this. This is from Image. And this is written by... it's written by Joe Henderson. The art and colorists are Lee Garbett and Antonio Fabela. And it is, I have to say, the colouring in this is just stunning. Like this particular one, not this one, this one. It is absolutely beautiful. It's basically about this young girl who lives in this world where gravity is no longer a thing. And her dad might have a way to fix that. But there are some baddies at play. But yeah, it's really cool. Not a lot of dialogue, a lot of action. And I can't wait to read the next one. So that is everything I consumed in the month of April. I hope you enjoyed this video. I will see you in the comments below for everything you have read in April. And if there is things on my list that you have read, watched, or listened to, let me know. Hope you have a wonderful day. Stay safe. And I will see you again soon for my May TBR.